Well, hello everybody. As you heard in the introduction, I will present a project that I've been working on in my NGO Documenta in Zagreb, Croatia. But first, before I present the project, let me just give you a short overview about the war in the 90s in Croatia. Please have in mind that it's a difficult war to understand, so I will just give you a really short overview just to understand better the project and the people we chose to record, as well as the period we chose for the stories. So the war that happened in Croatia between 91st and 95, as it is called, the Homeland War in Croatia, started together with the dissolution of Socialistic Federative Republic of Yugoslavia, when Croatia, together with some other countries in the Yugoslavia, decided to become independent. So there was a referendum in Croatia in which more than 94% of voters voted in favor of Croatia becoming a sovereign and independent country, which guarantees all the civil rights to its minorities, including Serbs, of course. After that point, after that referendum that was held in 1990, in 91st, a part of the Serbian population in Croatia started armed rebellion. In the parts of Croatia where Serbs had a significant ratio, there was a Republic of Serbian Krajina that they proclaimed, and it was more than one third of Croatian territory. Soon after that, in 91st, the conflict became an open war, and it was massively encouraged from Serbia, so armed conflict or open war started between Croatian armed forces, Yugoslav National Army, forces of Republic of Serbia and Krajina, together with different paramilitary forces from Serbia and Croatia. The war ended in 1995 after two major military operations and one peaceful agreement. In the second military operation, more than 200,000 Serbs from Croatia had to flee Croatia, and most of them never returned. Still in Croatia, you can rarely hear about those victims, and nobody has been prosecuted for that crimes. So as you can see, we are still dealing with a lot of baggage from the 90s, and we have a really difficult legacy to live with. But there's another problem, and that is that we still haven't dealt with the legacy that we have from the Second World War. And when I say that, I mean primarily the fact that during the socialistic Yugoslav Federation, after the Second World War, nobody mentioned the victims from the war. And all the focus in the dominant narrative was on the partisan movement as one of the biggest anti-fascist movements at that period in the world. So all the focus was on the partisans, on the fighters, streets and monuments were named after them, and schools and everything, and nobody mentioned the victims. Together with that, there's another group of victims that was not mentioned at all, and it wasn't openly spoken about in the public, and that's the victims that the mass murders that happened in 1945 after Second World War, where many of Ustasha Chetniks together with Arab civilians were killed at the end of the war as a punishment for their crimes from 1941. I also have to mention that together with that, we are dealing with a legacy of people that were detained on Goli Otok, or Naked Island in Croatia, where a lot of people were detained. And when I say a lot, I mean more than 11,000. And those were people that Tito accused of being Stalinists after 1948, when Tito and Stalin broke up. After the Infobüro resolution, Stalin accused Tito of not being Marxist enough, and so all the people in Yugoslavia that were considered Stalinists were detained on this that island. So I hope that I managed to give a short overview for you to understand with what we are dealing with. And regarding the 90s, I have to say that the only way that post-Yugoslav countries dealt with the legacy of war crimes from the 90s was primarily they focused on criminal prosecutions. Together with the Hague Tribunal, ICTY, and National Criminal Courts, there were some individuals that were brought to the face of justice, but of course it's pretty clear that not all war crime criminals were brought to the justice and were prosecuted. So that's one of the reasons why the civil society in Croatia, together with other countries in the region of Western Balkans, put an effort into dealing with the past the best they can. Documenta, the NGO that I'm working in and that started this project, is one of these NGOs. I have to say that majority of NGOs that are dealing with the past in Croatia now came in the public eye in the 90s, where they started in something that was called anti-war campaign movement that started in the early 90s in Croatia, where different human rights activists made a network with other human rights activists from other countries in the region to try to prevent ethnic conflict and, in the end, the war. Of course, they didn't succeed, but they, with their collaboration, they managed to make different NGOs that are still active, very much active in the region. So, Documenta, or Center for Dealing with the Past, was officially established in 2004 in the attempt to encourage social and individual processes of dealing with the past and establishing the factual truth about the war and war-related events. And the key reason for making this attempt was, as you could see before from all the things that I said, was the silence about and falsification of war crimes and other war-related events in the period from 1941 until present. And that definitely influenced a lot the recent past of Yugoslavia as well as all post-Yugoslav countries. So, since its establishment, Documenta contributes to the development of individual and social processes of dealing with the past in order to build a sustainable peace in Croatia and in other countries in the region by deepening dialogue and initiating public debate on public policies that encourage dealing with the past. Documenta is also collecting data, publishing research on war events and monitoring war crime trials. I would like to just mention, before I start presenting my project, I would just like to mention a few other projects that Documenta has. One of them is called Human Losses from 91 till 95. In which we are trying to collect all the personal data of all the people that were killed during the war in Croatia, because there is no exact number still in Croatia about how many people died in the war. There are some estimations and they go around 20,000 people in Croatia. We think it's really crucial to finish a project like that, to make a complete data about all people that were killed in the war, because from all the experience that Croatia and other countries had throughout the history, there was a lot of political and ideological manipulation of the number of people that were killed in previous conflicts such as the Second World War. Another interesting project is something that was a really, really huge project. It was an attempt to copy other examples of truth-telling and truth-seeking commissions that you have in Chile, Argentina, Canada, and other countries. So more than 1,800 NGOs, associations of victims, war veterans, together with different individuals, started an initiative to force, in a way, states of all seven ex-EU countries to establish a commission that would deal with all the things that happened during the wars in the 90s in Croatia, Bosnia-Herzegovina, Slovenia, Kosovo and others. The project is still ongoing. It's a huge project. I'm not sure, can I predict what will happen next, but if you ask me, I would really like for that project to succeed in a way that this commission would become alive. The idea is for the commission to be interstate or regional, so it would be officially established on the behalf of each state of ex-Yugoslav countries. Now, finally, I will tell you a little bit more about unveiling personal memories on war and detention in Croatia from 1941 until present. We are talking about an oral history project that proposes oral history as a method to collect and open up individual, personal, and subjective memories on past traumatic events from different perspectives in Croatia, including those of minorities, women, war veterans, refugees, etc. The key reason for such an attempt, as you can see for yourself from the things I mentioned earlier is our experience of silenced war events and other forms of political violence from 1941 until present. I strongly believe that this fact has significantly influenced the recent past of all ex-Yugoslav countries, and I feel that will most necessary reflect on future generations too if we not deal with it. So the aim of the project is to affirm personal memories of all interested witnesses and protagonists of historical events and preserve them from permanent loss. I believe that through recording and transferring of subjective experiences, it is possible to get a deeper insight into seemingly hidden aspects of political turmoil, and that such experiences would strengthen personal and social processes of dealing with the past, which I find a necessary precondition for sustainable peace in Croatia. It is my hope that revealing of the suffering of one's neighbor or people from other parts of the country, especially of those from different ethnical background, we might stimulate debate within local communities and contribute to establishment of dialogue between different social groups. So the goal is to contribute to creating a social climate where an awareness of different experiences from the war will encourage greater empathy and solidarity for all victims. I have to emphasize that the methodology that has been used in this project is based on oral history principles, but it also includes some specific requests that human rights organization working on dealing with the past, what Documenta is, have. First of all, it is giving an opportunity to people that weren't creators of historical events and were not on the positions of the power to share their memories. And second, it is insisting on multi-perspectivity and presenting of different narratives to the public. As you could see, Croatian society is still struggling when it comes to presenting different narratives, especially those outside the predominant narrative. So we recorded more than 400 video interviews with different people from Croatia, from different parts of Croatia. We also went to Bosnia and Herzegovina and Serbia to record memories of people that were expelled from Croatia and never returned. People were given an opportunity to choose for themselves the level publicity for the interviews, so some of them chose for the interviews to be public, and you can find them on our web platform croatianmemories.org, and some of the people chose for the interviews to be only available to researchers in Documenta. I have to explain why we chose such a long period, 1941 until present. We started doing this project as a smaller project in 2006, if I remember correctly, where we recorded audio interviews with people from eastern parts of Croatia, and we were focusing exclusively on the 90s. But without asking any specific questions other than the ones regarding the 90s, people always reflected, or very often reflected, on the things that happened in the Second World War. So for many people, events that took place in Croatia in the 90s were a direct continuation of events from the Second World War, and some even saw it as acts of revenge. So that's why we decided to make this project longer and to record memories of people from Second World War, period of socialistic Yugoslavia, and the 90s. I will just mention for a minute that we don't see the project to be finished yet, because at one point we realized that it is not enough to have the interviews online and to expect that many people will see them. Our priority is to make sure that as many people as possible see the interview, so we are trying to find funding to make different other projects in which this material, this data would be used, and we are trying to encourage scientific community in Croatia to use this material, as well as the material to be used in different artistic projects like exhibitions or theater plays or whatever, because it is pretty clear from the things that we saw after we made the collection that although even for some events people in Croatia think they know what happened, after you hear personal experiences from that specific events, it becomes really clear that there are stories untold and there are a lot of things beneath it. I will just mention one example. You probably all know about the city of Dubrovnik in Croatia, which was heavily destroyed during the war. But in Croatia, although this example is mentioned all the time as one of the main stories that has been told from the war, it's always the story of a beautiful historical city under UNESCO World Heritage program that has been destroyed in the 90s, and you can never hear about the victims from Dubrovnik. We recorded more than 30 people from Dubrovnik, and that was the first time for Croatian public to hear about their sufferings and months they spent under the siege of Dubrovnik without electricity, water, etc. So I think it's best for you to see the short clips from the interview, so you will understand better what I'm talking about. So,
Daphne,
please.
We have time
for that. Yeah, you can add another 5 minutes.
He was rushing me.
No, I mean, 20 minutes. Okay. 22 minutes.
Njemci su izmislili reporteri
that do rent in New Dorchik, or I was ever brought to the Rebashim, was I, which is the large. We have a rush for 20,000 people who are the fascism. A najveća, najveći broj ljudi je pasivno pod promaterom, bez neki aplauza njemačke kolone.
Mi smo završili u bivšim pogovorima. Roditelji, moji otac je ubijen odmah, tamo streljan. Sad ja ne znam točno mjesto gdje je streljan, a tu negdje, Kotkozar i Kozara, ne znam. Mi smo djeca pokupljeni, išli u koloni, eto, to je bio put Gradiška, Maka, Jasenovac do Siska. I mati je s nama krenula, gdje je ona, ja se točno ne sjećam, gdje je ona od nas odvojena, a sa mnom je bila i mala, mlađa od mene sestra, koja je završila isto u logoru u Sisku. Međutim, kada je moj, ajde da ga nazovem, počin ili koji me je uzeo iz logora. Ja sam bio previše malen i uplašen. Nisam njemu kad je došao po mene u sisački logor rekao uzmi moju sestru. Nego jer ja 8 dana kad je on mene uzeo iz logora nisam nijedne riječi progovorio.
Otac kao pripadnik Hrvatske vojske, kome su dva brata, vraćao se sa Blajburga, bio je tužan Blajburško u Kolombi, i dva brata su mu u Požegi odvojena, u kamione, i održeni su u Jasenovac ili Kozar, nije se znao točno gdje su završili, da ih se tamo ubija i da se neko na njima iživljava. Otac je shvatio u čemu se radi, pobjegao iz kolone i do Hercegovine išao 13-14 dana pješač i došao u Hercegovine.
Ja sam izišla, jedva sam se mukla, jer me voljelo. Veli, što se mučeš tako valno, veli jedna, iste brake. Pa veli, jesi ti članica UDBA i jesi uhapšenik. Meri, Vano, zaveš. Ja sam zavezala. Prebrojili su nas i rekli, idete na rad. Ja sam na to rekla, čujte, ja ne mogu jer teško hodam i teško ruke držim jer su me izmlatili. Prvi, samo ti idi i te kako ćeš raditi. I postrojili su nas u neke brigade, radne brigade, i poslali da kamen vučemo iz mora na vrh tog malog brda.
Sjećam se jedan put u Moki, malom izvoru ispod Nebodera, tamo smo pili kavu. Uletio je jedan mladić, tri policajca, tukli su ga penrekom ispod nas, svak se pravio kao da ništa ne vidi, jedno je nekome ovako malo drkano svima ruke, to je bila jedna nadrealna situacija. Mi imamo kavu, mi je tukli ispod nas.
Zato s time ta neka nesretna zapovjeta se izdvoje svi muškarci. I kako su oni njih izdvojili, tako se više mi njih više nismo vidjeli. I sjećam se tog momenta, tata se moj pozdravljao s nama i ja mislim, ono, još ga pitam, rekao, svićam se, zašto sve pozdravljaš? Ono, onako, pogledao mene, taj pogled, ono, u kojem možeš iščitati da je to neki zadnji naš susret, recimo. To meni toliko, meni to strašno ostalo osjećeno, mislim, ja to nikad zaboraviti ne mogu. Kao da je znao, da se mi više nikad osjećao. I 29.6. kad smo mislili da bi to moglo ići prema, da to vodi prema kraju, jer je već oslobođenje okolnih područja, nama dolazi do imperijalne, da za vrijeme večere u skloništu na vrata padne granata
i da svi nestanemo uprašeni, u njimu. I nakon, ja ne znam koliko to sekunda i minuta trajalo, ja u stvari nikoga nisam viđala oko sebe, ja sam samo u stvari kako mi je čir stala blizu mene, ja sam samo viđala nju u krvi i podigla sam nju i ja u tom strahu ja nisam znala, ni gdje mi je muž, ni gdje su mi druga dva sina. Kako sam ja saznala, jer je bila tako panična situacija i u bolnici, jer su oni granatirali centar starog grada, pa ih je bilo puno. U stvari su oni nas doveli u sobu gdje sam ja sa kćeri došla do mrtvoga sina.
Došli su na vrata, jer ja sam znala šta me čeka. Jer sam čula već na sve deložacije, izmolili su na vrata, lupali, da otvori. Ja sam povijela na špijunku, jedan cimir i jedan vratnica, čuje mi još kod lišta. Ja kažem, ja neću da otvorim ovo doma niko. Kažem, nećemo prvo provaliti. Onda su otišli i kaže, doćemo drugi put. I onda mi je jedan napravio šipke željezne. Jedan rođak napravio tri šipke koje su sa mnom. Na mne ajkice, pa onda bi ja očekali djeca legla, namučali te tri šipke, željezne dobe na sredini i gore na vrati. I onda kad su došli do 11 sati, to je pucalo, tri ulazna nisu spali. Kad su počeli marijevima i nekim šipkama lupati iz maska, pa puca je nosili iz zilje. Šipka ispane iz vršišta, ja je na mjesti. Čerka nije bila kući, sin je bio. I onda kad su upali unutra, agonija 24 sata je ta traja.
Mi imamo najmanj mali odlogak na spavanje i rano između 6 sata. Možemo oko pola pet, pa onda smo nas roditelji pobudili i rekli smo da se oblačimo, da idemo, moja kuća je pored pruge, iza pruge je jedna stara železnička kuća koja ima drugi podrum i oni su nam rekli da idemo gore da je počelo bombardiranje Knina. Čuva se jako detonacije da nas su padale, mislim to je bilo ono dosta kaotično, znači mislim budimo, još je bio mrak i odlazimo gore u biti taj podrum. Gdje su skupili ljudi iz tog jedna sela, mislim, bila nekoliko tih lokacija u selu gdje su ljudi skupili nekoliko podruma, nekakvi još stari njemački bunker i slično. I mislim, znam da je to bio ono, početak, i manje više cijeli dan su padali granate, a mi smo cijeli dan bili tamo bojili.